Nesbit story of the railway children, dramatized by Marcy Kahan.
We were not railway children to begin with. I don't suppose we ever thought about railways, except as a means of getting to the theatre, or the zoo, or Madame Tussauds.
We were just ordinary suburban children.
Roberta, the eldest. Everyone called me Bobby.
And Peter.
And Phyllis, the youngest.
We had a mother who did not spend all her time paying dull calls to dull ladies.
She was almost always there, ready to play with us, and read to us, and help us with our homework.
And she used to write stories for us.
And we had a father who was just perfect. Never cross, never unjust, and always ready for a game.
If he was not ready, he always had an excellent reason for it.
We had everything we needed.
Pretty clothes, good fires, heaps of toys.
And a dog called James.
We ought to have been very happy.
We were very happy.
Only we didn't know how happy.
Not until the dreadful change.
It came quite suddenly. Peter got a model engine for his 10th birthday. And after only 3 days, he broke it.
Phyllis broke it?
I did not!
You did so!
At any rate, we all waited until Father came home and had had his dinner and his after-dinner cigar.
Father was most clever with his fingers.
All our hopes were pinned on Father.
I suppose you want to listen to your gramophone, Father.
We don't blame you if you do.
And not be bothered with accidents.
Accidents? What's this about accidents?
Now, dear, if you're quite comfy, the children want to tell you about the great railway accident and show you Exhibit A.
Your new steam engine, Peter? What happened?
It sort of exploded.
And Peter cried.
I didn't cry. I had a cold. Is there no hope, Father?
Hope? Tons of it. It needs a new valve. I think we'd better reserve Saturday afternoon. And you shall all help me.
Can girls help to mend engines?
Of course. Girls are just as clever as boys, and don't you forget it. How would you like to be an engine driver, Phil?
My face would always get dirty.
I should just love it. Do you think I could when I'm grown up, Daddy? Or even a stoker?
You mean fireman. Well, if you still wish it when you're grown up, we'll see about making you a firewoman. I remember when I was a boy. Come.
Two gentlemen to see you, sir.
Oh, dear. A little late for visitors, Ruth, I think.
I did explain that, sir, but they wouldn't listen.
Oh? Well, what are the gentlemen's names?
They wouldn't give names. I'm sorry, sir, they were very forceful. I've shown them into the study.
Who on earth? If an Englishman's home is his castle, why don't they equip suburban villas with moats and drawbridges?
I expect it's the choir holiday fund. Get rid of them quickly, dear. It's nearly the children's bedtime.
I shan't be long.
I wish we had got a moat and drawbridge. Then when we didn't want people, we could just pull up the drawbridge and no one else could get in.
And Ruth could be a fire-breathing dragon in the moat, frightening people away.
Better not let Ruth hear you say that.
Why not? It's more fun being a dragon than a parlour maid. Isn't that so, Mother?
I expect so, dear.
I want to hear Father's story about when he was a boy.
He may have forgotten by now.
Then why don't I help pass the time with a brand new story about a princess with green eyes.
Yes, please. A princess with green eyes and a fire-breathing dragon named Ruth and a brave heroic girl named Phyllis and a little...
Quiet, Phil, listen.
I've no idea what you're talking about.
So you say, sir.
So I say? Of course I say. It happens to be the truth.
At last, Father's rung to have them shown out.
Thank goodness they're going.
Why were they shouting, Mother?
Ruth?
Please, Mum, the master wants you to step into the study. He looks like the dead. I think it's bad news. A death in the family.
That'll do, Ruth. You can go. As for you, my dears, don't look so worried.
Don't worry. Mother will sort it out.
She'll terrify them. She'll send them packing. You'll hear their screams all the way down the street.
Shh! Listen.
You really must insist, sir. You are making a very grave mistake.
This is perfectly dreadful.
What are they saying?
Ruth!
They're calling Ruth.
Bobby, I don't like it.
I know. There's an awful lot of commotion.
they've gone.
Thank goodness.
Mother?
It's bedtime, darlings. Ruth will put you to bed.
But you promised we could sit up late and talk to Father.
Father's been called away on business.
But Mother, it's night time.
I know, darlings. It can't be helped.
Won't Father come in and kiss us goodnight?
He asked me to kiss you goodnight on his behalf.
Where's Daddy gone?
I can't tell you anything more. Now be good, darlings. Go on up.
It wasn't bad news, Mummy. Is anyone dead?
Nobody's dead. No. Go, dear. Go now.
It was all very mysterious. Phyllis and I went straight up, but Peter waited for Ruth on the stairs.
Ruth?
Master Peter, you should be in bed.
I say, Ruth, what's up?
Ask no questions and you'll be told no lies. You'll know soon enough.
And later, when Mother came up and kissed us as we lay asleep, I was the only one whom the kiss woke. I said to myself, if Mother doesn't want us to know she's been crying, we won't know it, that's all.
When we came down to breakfast the next morning, Mother had already gone out.
And she wasn't home at 1 o'clock, dinner, nor at tea time.
It was nearly 7 before she came in.
Now, my darlings, I want to tell you something. Those men last night did bring very bad news, and Father will be away for some time. I want you all to help me by being good and happy and not quarrelling when I'm away, for I shall have to be away a good deal.
We won't quarrel, Mother.
Indeed we won't.
Also, I want you to promise not to ask me any questions about this trouble, and not to ask anybody else.
I did ask Ruth. I'm very sorry, but I did.
What did Ruth say?
She said I'll know soon enough.
No, Peter. It's not necessary that you should know at all. It's about business.
Government business, Mother?
Yes. Now, it's bedtime, my darlings. Don't worry. It'll all come right in the end.
Don't you worry either, Mother. We'll all be as good as gold.
We'll begin first thing tomorrow.
Why not now?
There's nothing to be good about now, silly.
We might begin to try to feel good and not call names.
Who's calling names? Bobby knows that when I say silly, it's just the same as if I say Bobby.
I don't know any such thing.
I mean, it's just what is it Father calls it? A germ of endearment. Good night.
Everything continued to be perfectly horrid for some weeks.
Mother was nearly always out.
Meals were dull and dreary.
Then one day, Mother came down to breakfast very pale and with lines on her face that used not to be there.
Now, my pets, everything is settled. We're going to leave this house and go and live in the country. Such a dear little white house. I know you'll love it.
Of course we will, Mother.
We must be all packed by the weekend.
We're not being forced to leave, are we, Mother?
Of course not, Phyllis. It's just time we had an adventure.
I never imagined we owned so many things. Crockery, blankets, candlesticks, bedsteads, sauce.
What about the red turtle shell cabinet?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.